Hey everyone, I'm Rather Incoherent, and today I'm going to talk about 5 decks I'm looking forward to playing in upcoming campaigns. For some of these characters, it's in an attempt to reevaluate them with a larger card pool and, to some degree, new strategies. For others, they're characters I've seen played but never personally played, and I've finally found something that makes me really want to play them. Our first deck today is going to be this fighter side list that's definitively in the latter category. Sea Change Harpoon is the core of the deck. You get +1 for this attack. If you committed skills to this test, it deals +1. And when it ends, if you return Sea Change Harpoon to your hand, then you can return all of the committed skills instead of discarding them. That's sort of like knocking the Ornate Bow, except it costs you 3 resources to knock it. However, the maximum upside is tremendously higher than the Ornate Bow. Because rather than just like doing it to get back one long shot, towards the end of a scenario when you've cycled most of your deck because you're a Silas with Unrelenting, you can commit both long shots to a test, and both strong arms, and a quick thinking. And then if you draw the autofail, no you didn't, and you can hit for 6, guaranteed. And likely that's all you'll need to do, but if it's really the boss and it has a ton of hit points, you can just do it a second time with your fire extinguisher or your time worn brand, or more likely, your meat cleaver before you have a finished deck. It's the addition of long shot and strong armed from Hemlock Vale that really lets Silas break out of the nightmare that red fighters live in, where their best weapons are all just slightly improved machetes. Chainsaws never really had the support in my eyes to be a great weapon, and it's these new skills that Silas is getting access to that might let him really shine and be a much better fighter than he previously was. It's something I'll still have to play with and see. Is he actually Mythos resilient with Sparrow Mask, Pete, and Cherished Keepsake? Probably. Is he reliable with Backpack to find the Harpoon before a ball shows up? Probably. Will he be able to get not all, but most of his skills to the final boss? Probably. Is Lucky going to be a worse card to run than New Catastrophe? Almost certainly. There's going to be changes to this deck before I play it, and when I play it, it'll probably end up being really fun to play, but actually a little bit worse than I expect it to. But the addition of these new skills with Strong Armed and Long Shot make the Harpoon a good enough weapon for me to really enthusiastically look forward to a Silas fighter deck instead of feeling like he's a poster child for bad red fighters. Now that's kind of Hank's job to be the poster child for lack of good weapons within the red class. Moving on to a Kluver, we have a Winifred deck that I'm looking forward to trying. Winifred really can't make good use out of Big Money due to her ability. Big Money tends to forgo skills entirely, and when you have an ability that wants you to run half a deck filled with skills bare minimum, it doesn't really work. Additionally, with a 5 in foot and a ton of skills, you're set up great use pilfer, which doesn't really jive with hoarding your money for stuff like the Black Van. This is a pretty bare bones deck running basically just easy marks for economy, because we're relying on Thieves Kit for the rest of the economy and getting a lot more of that Thieves Kit by putting it into play with Sleight of Hand. We're going to spend the excess economy on Lola, who's also just giving us our core skills, and this deck really is just pure Kluver, using lockpicks, thieves kits, and pilfer. Breaking and entering is here because, like, you just gotta throw that in, there's no reason not to run it. But on the whole, I feel like this is the most balanced and effective Winifred deck I can build, and the thing that finally made me enthusiastic about playing a Winifred was the sleight of hand thieves kit combo, because for most characters it feels like if you're investigating there's better things you can do, and if you're flexing or fighting, then this really has no place in your deck, unless you build like an incredibly janky combo flex deck where you're also using sleight of hand with weapons. This is, to me, like the most legit use for sleight of hand in the game right now, you know, barring anything that is reason for it to be tabooed, although I think the current taboo has dealt with most of those. There could be other things that I'm missing. The big thing for me is just I wanted to play Winifred for a while, and every list I made, if it was flexing, felt like there wasn't quite room to do everything I wanted. If it was fighting, it wasn't running pilfer, so I felt like I needed to run Kluver and I couldn't find the thing that made the deck click. And after hearing about Sleight of Hand Thieves Kit, I think that's the Winifred list that I want to run and want to play sometime soon. Moving on to a character I've seen others play and want to finally play myself, I want to play the most boring Dexter Drake deck imaginable. Just, how do you fight Cyclopean Hammer? Shriveling's a backup. How do you find clues? Mystic assets. What's your Dexter synergies? Empty Mystic Assets, Earthly Serenity, Scroll of Secrets, that's it. It's just the most boring, efficient Dexter deck imaginable, because every time I see someone play Dexter, they have fun with it. And I feel like that's making me underrate Dexter, because they keep doing things that are not just like the boring, efficient thing available to the character. And you might look at this and say, Scroll of Secrets has some rather obvious anti-synergy with Cyclopean Hammer, to which I would respond, if Cyclopean Hammer is in play, I don't care what negative things are happening, things are going great. Scroll of Secrets is critical to finding the Cyclopean Hammer and to finding your other cards as well. If you draw it after Cyclopean Hammer, that's unfortunate, but we're probably already like above average in terms of results if Cyclopean Hammer is in play and preventing us from getting our Scroll of Secrets down. I don't have a ton to say about this deck. This is just what I think the most generic and powerful Dexter deck is. It took me a while to settle on exactly how I wanted to build it, but once I do get around to playing it, I'm looking forward to trying it. Next up, we have Lily Chen, another fighter. Lily Chen is a character, I think in my very first campaign I played on YouTube, I ran Lily Chen alongside Jenny Barnes and Carcosa. And it was like right after Edge of the Earth came out, and I thought if she got some more weapons and some more support, she'd go to the moon. It's not in the final deck, but Machete's been untabooed. She's been given access to Strong Armed for the entirety of the weaponry she can use, barring Brandicathuga, I guess. And she has been given Runic Axe, which is the king of weaponry. The deck has just been given a lot of very direct support, and I think I've been sleeping on her a little bit because she's boring and she deserves to move up in my tier list. This is, again, like a pretty bog standard deck. The only thing of worth noting here is the thing that pushed me into really wanting to play her is this deck sort of lacks draw a little bit. It's got Tetsuo. You can look at things like cutting some stuff to make room for backpacks and staying on the Machetes. And then when you use your foot discipline to make the big multi-attack later on, you just don't worry about Brandicathuga. Instead, it's like Runic Axe, Spectral Razor, and Sweeping Kick. And it's fine that Machete's not in play to be comboed with it. For me personally, I've just been hoping to like get some more draw available, stand togethers, stick to the plans, running more neutral skills than you otherwise might. And the breaking point for me being hyped about Lily was actually Second Wind coming out in the next expansion. When I play this, I intend to proxy that card because I'll almost certainly play this before the expansion comes out. And just having access to some horror healing, making it easier to like take a split of soak initially, having access to more draw to find your weapon more quickly. And again, it's probably more okay for Lily than most to just say you're going to have to find Runic Axe the hard way, because Lily's able to run Spectral Razors, she's happy to put a Sweeping Kick under stick to the plan, and she doesn't want to burn it fighting early, but she can. She'll have 5 fists to kill rats. Like, I'm not thrilled about the consistency at a glance with this deck, but I think it's probably good enough. And before anyone asks, I look at this and I desperately want to put Bestow Resolve in, because come on, I run everything but Perception. The issue is I already run Promise of Power, which largely accomplishes the same thing that a Bestow Resolve does, just as a 1 of 0 experience card. It's also very likely this enchant weapon is gross overkill and shouldn't be in the deck, and it should be anything that draws. But the idea is, even if it's not exactly this deck, if I keep tinkering with it, I want to run Runic Axe Lily Chen that starts off with a Machete. And speaking of that first Carcosa game alongside Jenny Barnes, I want to replay Jenny Barnes. In that game, I think I was technically double flex, and I was running 6 cents on my Lily, and I came away from that campaign feeling like running any clue finding cards in Lily had been a waste of time, she wasn't very good at it, and if you're a bodyguard as good as Lily, you should expect a Kluver who can more than carry your weight, and you don't need to contribute on the clue game. Jenny, as a result, maybe wasn't stress test as a Kluver in the way she should have been, was able to hide behind the shield of flex a little bit, and I want to really reevaluate winning. I want to play again with the Green Man Medallion. Sure, my table's gonna love that if I end up playing it with them instead of playing it in like a two-fisted fashion. But the big thing with Jenny is I think I have been exaggerating how bad she is in early scenarios as an excuse to put her in C tier. Because while this end deck with double-double and the hoarding stuff for Rogue is really cool and all, the question isn't, is this a good deck? You're probably going to end the campaign with more experience than this, to be honest. The question is not, is this deck going to be good? It's going to be very strong. It's going to dominate whatever scenario it's in. You're going to very quickly be playing double-double on to read the signs. I have interesting questions like, should I be running instead of something? I guess read the signs would be it. Should I just be running like thorough inquiry to make sure I find the cards I need quickly? Is double-double to spend 3 actions playing thorough inquiry to draw 10 cards worth it? Is that a good thing? There's definitely a ton of room in the current card pool for experimentation with the final version of Jenny Barnes. This isn't really what I need to test. The question is not about this Jenny deck. There's optimization that can be done to it, I'm sure. I doubt this is completely perfect, The question is really about this Jhinny deck. Essentially, the entire question with Jhinny is, if you play Jhinny as your team's main Kluver, in session one, how's it go? Do you get all the victory points? Or do you weigh your team down and the experience you're getting with Green Man Medallion is costing your teammates experience? If the answer is you get all the victory points, Jhinny's a great character. If the answer is you weigh your team down, that's pretty unfortunate. Jhinny's kind of bad then. There's also some wiggle room to it, right? Like if Jhinny gets a free double-double and gains 8 experience, and your teammates all lose 1 victory point, that's a net 5 XP gain to the team. I'm sure your teammates aren't happy about it, but from a game theory perspective, that is advantageous to the team. So the question is, pretty much entirely, can Jhinny do her job as main Kluver? You can definitely play Jhinny Barnes as flex and just weigh your team down to some degree and burn money, and by scenario 2, the extra XP you've gotten is enough to make up for the fact that you're going to spend some amount of the scenario burning money. The question's entirely, how much is this weighing us down in scenario 1? How bad is our early game, really? Which is something I'll be watching like a hawk when I actually play this character. I'm not convinced if this is literally the best I can do or if it's just close. I know you have to run easy marks because you need the money to burn and you need the draw to find the book boost to do your job. I know you need Fox Mass, Streetwise, and Well Connected just for the stat pumps to do your job. And I know you need to do easy marks with something else, Karen's Obel's Madness, because the only thing that matters is getting out of scenario 1 okay, you'll be great after that. So Savant, I think, is the best 2 experience I can spend in the deck. Lockpicks kinda makes sense, but the base value is only 6, and we already want to run Magnifying Glasses, so I'm not sure. Like, I'm really, really interested in just figuring out, where's Jhinny really on the tier list? Because I think I've been underranking her low in C for a while. I think she's at least bottom of B. And if she does well when I test her, I'm probably gonna move her into the A tier, because she really is just, like, degenerate. This is a low-end estimate. I want to be clear about that. There's no shot that you end a Green Man campaign in anything other than Dunwich with less than 70 experience. Let's say that an average campaign these days gives 45 experience, and let's say your Green Man Medallion underperforms, right? You never get more than 4 experience with it. And sometimes you're only going to get 3, say you get a Lola or something, or a Charisma with it. Let's say it's 3 to 4, average 3.5. That is still 7 times 4 is 28 experience bonus in the campaign. 45 plus 28, that's 73. So like, not full experience for a modern campaign, really low end estimate of what the Green Man gives you, is still a little bit more than this. When you go into the end game of a campaign with this much experience, the deck is going to do disgusting things. I'm gonna cut myself off, and I feel like I've fully articulated the case with Jhinny and how it's the starting deck that matters, because I can go in circles forever on this. All that matters is, does this level 0 deck get the job done? If you beat scenario 1 with full completion with this list, then the argument I've been making to keep Jhinny in C tier, which is her early game is bad, is not a consistent, valid argument. To me, it looks like while this deck is bad, it should be good enough to full complete a scenario 1. Like, this is roughly on par with the amount of clues I would expect out of Kluver Bob, who just barely got the job done. Like, it felt terrible, it wasn't good, but unlike Kluver Bob, there's a reason to go through it on this. I hope that's the case. I might just play Jhinny again and cause everyone to have a bad time, but I'm thinking that this character is actually much better than I've been giving it credit for. Anyways, that's it for me. I've been Rather Go Herent. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.